In today's session, we will be starting off with a brand new topic. This session will be focusing on ratio analysis. We must be quite familiar with this term, ratio analysis. As the name suggests, this chapter deals with the analysis of ratios. So what really are ratios? Ratio analysis refers to a technique which is deployed as a part of management accounting, and it is primarily used for further analysis of the values. And by carrying out these analyses, we are hoping to get some more insights, some more outlook, some more views, perspectives regarding the values, regarding the indications of the values which are disclosed in the financial statements. So the source for us to carry out ratio analysis, we would be depending on one of the financial statements. And from these financial statements, we will be going about carrying out analysis on the values which are disclosed over there, and through which we are hoping to arrive at more deeper insights. And that is the entire objective or outlook about what ratio analysis is all about. Now, ratio analysis is one of the most powerful tools which are used as a part of management accounting, because the potential of this is immense. It can give us solid insights to, and it is deployed in all the companies irrespective of their scale, starting all the way from large organizations to small organizations. If they can use ratio analysis, and ratio analysis will help them to draw a lot of conclusions, especially at the top management level, whenever key decisions have to be taken, the dependency would be always based on the inputs that are derived as a part of ratio analysis. Now, what is really ratio? In a nutshell, ratio is an arithmetic expression. It is a method, it is a methodology, it is an approach whereby which you would be indicating some numerical value. So how exactly are ratios indicated, or how exactly are ratios depicted? So ratios are calculated by computing one value against another. So you would have a numerator, then you would have a denominator, and then you're basically calculating ratios to understand what is the relationship between the numerator and the denominator. So that in a nutshell is how you go about with ratio analysis. Now here what happens is both the numerator and the denominator, you would be depending on the values which are given in the financial statement. And from these financial statement values, you will be going about drawing the conclusion. So ratio analysis, in a nutshell, it is a mathematic expression. Now let's talk a little bit more about ratios. The definition of a ratio is that ratio is an expression of the quantitative relationship between two numbers. It talks about a relationship, and the relationship which is established between the numerator and the denominator, this is quantitative in nature. It talks about in terms of numbers. You have the denominator, then you have the numerator. So the numerator versus the denominator, by carrying out this calculation, you will be able to understand certain key aspects regarding the organization. So each of these ratios, it is calculated, it is computed to understand certain key aspects. So for example, it could be profitability, it could be liquidity, it could be leverage. So by calculating this, we will be able to understand how well is the company doing on. So this in a nutshell is what is meant by ratio analysis. Let's focus on the uses of ratio analysis. We will be learning around 6 to 7 uses of ratio analysis. The first application of ratio analysis is the decision making. Ratio analysis is used especially by the top management, and it is used to help the top management to take decisions, critical and key decisions which are relating to the organization, relating to channelizing the investments, channelizing money, channelizing the capital expenditures. These are taken with the help of ratio analysis. Now, whenever we look at any of the financial statements, we would see that the financial statements, it indicates the absolute values. So for example, if you see value of stock is given as 1 lakh, or value of cash is given as 2 lakhs, or value of machinery is given as 38 lakhs. So these are absolute values. By merely looking at these absolute values, it may not be possible for you to draw any meaningful conclusions. It may not be possible for you to come down and then arrive at some meaningful conclusions. So for this, you have to derive the relative values. Now, what do you mean by relative values? By looking at relative values, you're trying to establish the relationship between the items. So for example, you have value A, then you have value B. How is value A related to value B? So this is called as relative values. So ratio analysis helps the management in converting absolute value information into relative value information. So for example, current ratio, there's a ratio which is called as current ratio. Current ratio, the value is current asset divided by current liability. The formula for calculating that is current asset divided by current liability. Now, current asset, you would find in balance sheet. Current liability, again, you would find in balance sheet. Now, by merely looking at these two values in the balance sheet, you cannot come to any conclusion. But the moment you take current asset and current liability and you calculate the current ratio, you're able to understand the liquidity position. Now that absolute value has been converted into a relative value. So this is the first application. Second application is that it helps in forecasting and planning. For the business to grow, it is very important for them to plan the future. They must be able to have a projection regarding the future growth. Let's say the company is anticipating X amount of sales to accommodate for that X amount of sales. How much of staff do they need? How much of support systems do they need? So these kind of aspects are taken with the help of what is called as forecast. So every business would do what is called as a business forecast. By carrying out a business forecast, what will happen is the business will project and they will try and see how likely or what is the future of the business. How likely is the business likely to grow in the future? So that is what is meant by forecast. Now, based on the forecast, what happens is your other verticals of management will go about taking key decisions. So to accommodate for those growth, what are the kind of support systems that would be needed? So for example, if you're anticipating 100 crores sales, do you have sufficient staff? Do you have sufficient infrastructure? Do you have sufficient logistics? So these are the kind of things which come into picture when you look at the forecast. Then you have communications and coordination. Now, it is just not enough for the information to be available with the top management. So it has to be communicated with the other domains, other areas of the management. So this is the place where they would be utilizing the information which is conveyed. Also, whatever calculations, whatever computations, whatever analysis that you are drawing from ratio analysis, it can be communicated to the various departments of a company. Now, by communicating this to the different departments in a company, it facilitates better coordination. So, for example, the operations department has forecasted a sales of 1 lakh. Now, for that 1 lakh sales, you need marketing team, you need HR team, you need finance team. So unless and until all these teams come together and they work in tandem, it may not be possible. Another beautiful application of ratio analysis is that ratio analysis will add more value to the information that you can derive from the financial statements. So it helps to communicate in a better way to the various stakeholders in an organization. The fourth application is that it helps you to evaluate the profitability position. So by understanding the profitability position, there are various benefits that your organization stands to have. You can plan out your activities, you can communicate, you can decide on your employees' fringe benefits, you can plan out for their monetary compensations, you can communicate with the stakeholders, you can communicate that with the investors, you can convey that information to your financial institutions. So these are some of the applications of ratio analysis. The next application is related with stock trading. So in stock market, for you to participate in stock trading, you need to have a better understanding about the company. Is the company really doing well? Is the company doing excellent? Is it a wise decision to invest into the stocks of this company? So these kind of indications are provided with the help of fundamental analysis. So with the help of fundamental analysis, we can go about with the calculations of values such as EPS, dividend payout ratio, etc. So these are some of the indicators which are used by stock investors. So by utilizing on these values, what happens is you will be able to understand, are these companies doing quite well? And depending on that, you will be able to take certain key positions. Next is you will have credit evaluation by financial institutions. So whenever you approach any institution, any bank or any NBFC for a loan, they would be doing certain evaluation to try and see, is your company truly deserving? Okay, is the company in a position to evaluate and see, are you in that kind of a position where you're worthy for that kind of a loan? So for example, let's say you have your company is making a profit of 1 lakh, but you decide to go for a loan of 1 crore. Okay. So what happens in such cases is that it will be very difficult for your company to accommodate and then pay off that kind of a money. So in such cases, what happens is you need some support systems. You need some support systems in place, which will help you to understand and see, is the company really in a position or is the company truly worthy of this kind of thing? So for these kind of evaluations, for sure, you would be needing the help of ratio analysis. Then next thing is tax and audit purpose. So as a part of tax statutory requirement, it is mandatory for your business to calculate certain ratios and disclose them to the concerned authorities. So what is mentioned by clause 32 of income tax, where it is mandatory for the business to calculate the profitability ratios. So there are certain parts of ratios which are mandated by law. Okay, and because it is mandated by law, what happens is it is important for your business to go about with the calculations, with the computations, and then they will have to go about with these evaluations. Okay, so this is what is meant by tax and audit purpose. So you would be needing to calculate some of these ratios as a part of statutory compliance. In this part, we will be focusing on the limitations of ratio analysis. We will be discussing 5 limitations of ratio analysis. The first limitation is that lack of adequate standards. So for most of the ratios, what happens is there are no baseline values which are defined. So it is very difficult for us to know, is this value really ideal? So for example, current ratio, the standard value is 2. So if the standard value of current ratio is less than 2, it means the company is not doing too well. If it's above 2, it means the company is doing quite well. So that is a standard value which is defined. However, this is not the case in the case of majority of the ratios. For majority of the ratios, we do not have any well-defined standards which are available. So as a result of which, it makes it very difficult for us to rely on the interpretations of some of these values. So because we do not have adequate standards available, interpretations of ratios will become quite challenging. Next point is it requires expert or trained professionals. For us to evaluate the ratios, we require an expert. Someone's expertise is required. You need someone who's qualified in that domain of ratio analysis to go about with the computations of ratios. Third point is interpretations of ratios are individual centric. So how I am interpreting ratios would not be how someone else would be interpreting ratios. So the interpretations of ratios are individual centric. It would vary from individual to individual. Fourth point is possibility for window dressing. Now there is a lot of possibility that you could manipulate the ratio analysis values, and because you're manipulating the ratio analysis values, there is a possibility for window dressing. So window dressing is something which is not quite healthy. So that is also not appreciated. The last limitation is that the usage of ratio analysis, it depends on a person's knowledge and experience. So probably a person who has got deep understanding about the functioning of a company, who's got deep knowledge of company, how he would be looking at ratios is not how someone else would be looking at ratios. So this calls out for a need for people who have wisdom in this area. So these are the five limitations of ratio analysis. Now we would be discussing the classifications of ratios. Ratios can be broadly classified into three. There are three broad classifications to ratios: traditional classification, functional classification, and then you have significance classification. So these are three broad means based on which you can go about with the classification of ratios. Now, each of these classifications we would be dealing in detail. So the first classification that we will be talking about is traditional classification. Traditional classification, the ratios can be classified into three. You have balance sheet ratio, profit and loss ratio, and then you have composite ratio. The first classification is the traditional classification. Here, the ratios are classified based on source. Based on the source of the information, you can classify them into three. So the three classifications that we have are balance sheet ratio, profit and loss ratio, composite ratio. So as the name suggests, here the ratios are classified into three based on the source. So balance sheet ratio, what happens is both the numerator and the denominator, you will be deriving that from the balance sheet. So for example, current ratio, the formula is current asset divided by current liability. Current asset is again from balance sheet. Current liability is also from balance sheet ratio. Profit and loss ratio. Profit and loss ratio, what happens is both the numerator and the denominator, they would be again from the income statement. So one example is gross profit ratio. Then we have composite ratio. What happens in composite ratio is that either the numerator or the denominator would be from balance sheet and the other would be from the income statement. Okay, so here what happens is either the numerator or the denominator would be from the balance sheet and the other would be from the opposite statement or the other statement. So example, what I have denoted over here, stock turnover ratio. So stock is from balance sheet, net profit is from the income statement. That is how you calculate the stock turnover ratio. Now another name is for this classification is that it is also called a statement ratios. Another name is statement ratios. Then the next classification that we will be discussing is the functional classification. Functional classification is here ratios are classified based on the application. So based on the applications of ratios, we have four major classifications: liquidity ratio, leverage ratio, activity ratio, profitability ratio. Let's discuss each of these classifications in detail. The first is the liquidity ratio. So liquidity ratio is an indication of the liquidity position of the firm. What is meant by liquidity position? Liquidity position is a measure of solvency of the firm. It talks about how well is the company equipped to meet or fulfill its obligations. Any obligations, any financial commitments that the organization has, how well is the business equipped to meet them? Or how well is the business equipped in terms of paying them off? That is what is meant by liquidity ratios. So one example of liquidity ratio is the current ratio. Then you have leverage ratio. So what is meant by leverage ratio? Leverage ratio, it is an indication of the talks about the long-term solvency. How well is the company in a position to raise any sources of finance should there be a need? It also talks about the long-term sources of finance. So we know that there are two sources of finance a business has: long-term sources, short-term sources. Long-term sources includes debentures, equity shares, etc. Short-term would include short-term loans, overdraft, etc. So liquidity talks more of short-term loans, short-term borrowings. Leverage ratio talks about long-term borrowings. The next classification is the activity ratios. So activity ratios, these are ratios which helps you to understand how well is the business utilizing the resources that are available. These are also sometimes referred to as turnover ratios. So whatever resources that are available with the company, how well is the company utilizing them in terms of generating profitability for the firm. So that is what is meant by activity ratio. So for example, inventory turnover ratio. What happens in inventory turnover ratio talks about the relationship between the stock of a company against the profit of the company. The final classification that we have is the profitability ratio. In profitability ratio, what happens is it talks about the overall performance of the organization. Here we are talking about the profit, the values of profit. So short-term profits, long-term profits, what are the relationship between the aspects of the financial aspects with the profit values. So this is what is meant by profitability ratios. Then the final classification that we have is the significance ratio. So this classification is also called as the importance ratios. So here what happens is the ratios are classified based on its importance. How important is this ratio to understand the position of the firm? So we have two kinds of ratios. You have primary ratio and then you have secondary ratio. Primary ratios are those ratios of an organization which are very important. These ratios, it is needed. Calculation of these ratios are needed. It is very vital for your firm. So that is the reason why it is called as the primary ratios. Then you have secondary ratios. Secondary ratios are those ratios which are not so important. Okay. Even if these ratios are not calculated, it is fine. You still do not need them. So that is called as secondary ratios. So with that, we have touched upon the classifications of ratios. We've dealt with three classifications. You have the traditional classification, functional classification, and then finally you have the significance classification.